Yup. Just a little bit of pixie dust.
It is what it is. Wishes. So, anyway, all right. Well, this is the awkward part. Welcome into the Pixie Dust Brigade Podcast. Number one, I am Jason.
I'm JD.
And here we are. We've been wanting to do this for quite some time and just been kicking a can for quite some time. And yeah, now we're finally here and it's great. Except I'm in Texas and you're in Florida, very far away, but you're in a good part of Florida, the part that I'm jealous of to not be at. So you know,
yes, but you keep talking about moving here, so when is that gonna actually happen?
I know, I even got hired by the mouse at some point and, you know, had to let the mouse down. I'm sure he was so upset, just devastated, like, oh no, not another, you know, unrepaired car forever. But yeah, at some point I might be in my 50s whenever I make it happen, but
well, that's only another year away.
It's not too far. It's getting closer all the time. And that's it'll be very fitting too. It'll be very fitting. I'll blend right in. So that's all right. But yeah, so like we deliberated over the name of our, you know, content machine here. And but the biggest thing is like I became more, I guess, in love with Disney and Disney parks, things like that, in about 2016, whenever, you know, I took my family for the first time and it just kind of blew my mind and I was like, this is where I want to be. And since then we've gone a few times and then I always try to visit with you when we go, and so I'm really glad you relocated there, you know. But if you were like relocated to Montana, still maybe make it to the Montana theme park, but
I wouldn't expect anybody to come visit me in Montana. No disrespect to that state, but you know,
living on Dude Ranch.
I'm from Utah, which is not too far from there, and I can't take the cold anymore, man. I am glad to be down here in the warm states.
Yeah, no, I get it. Although I prefer like 70 degrees, low humidity, you know. Texas, where I live, it's brutal, of course, and it kind of gets a little old when I don't get the nice breeze across my state, but any hoot. So for you, you know, what got you, why are you living in Florida? Like, why did you choose to live where you happen to live in the shadow of, you know, this one building?
Well, so my love of Disney started when I was a child. My family used to take annual road trips down to Anaheim when I was a kid growing up in Utah. We'd always stop in Vegas and check out the lights, but then end up in Anaheim visiting the Mouse House there, the original Mouse House. Fell in love with it. And when I had kids of my own, we used to visit Disneyland, and then we visited Disney World. And when I was finally out of the military and able to choose a place that I wanted to call my permanent home, there was no real other answer than the Sunshine State. Yeah. I was lucky enough to actually find a spot here in Orlando, nonetheless.
And good timing as well. And that's another thing about JD and myself is like, we were both in the Army and we used to work together for some time at the place they affectionately call the Great Place. Whoever came up with that was a marketing pro, which of course they recently changed the name of that place to Fort Cavazos. And
I'm glad you know the name of it, because I could never remember.
Well, yeah, and like if Fort Bragg is Fort Liberty. You know, it's just like they pick names out of a hat. Although Cavazos, I think that was a general as well. So a man of the people for sure, you know, most certainly.
I know there was meaning behind it.
Yeah, I'm sure there always is, you know, like Fort Bragg became Fort Liberty. We had Camp Liberty in Iraq. I don't know if that's the connection or just, you know, how much liberty you get as a soldier to do so many things, tons of liberty. So, you know, the liberty after military is so much better. You know,
I really have liberty to grow my hair now.
You have liberty to sleep in. You know, if the sun's up, you don't have to feel guilty.
I don't have that liberty right now. I got to get kids on the bus in the morning.
Kids on the bus, Gus, and then off to work, you know. Yes. Hi-ho. So, but that's like, you know, again, like in our background and stuff like that, we kind of like work in this field in a sense, you know, content creation and whatnot. So, again, we like just really wanted to do this and, you know, have another damn Disney vlog or whatever, you know, but like try to bring something that I don't want to say that others aren't, but, you know, just our own viewpoints and stuff. And then, and as it grows and whatnot, you know, we'll just see where it takes us.
Well, talk a little bit about what makes, your vantage point a little bit different that maybe helped inspire this blog a little bit.
I don't have one. I have no vantage points.
Special circumstances with your family and whatnot.
Yeah, well, no, for sure. Like, so that was that's another, you know, an avenue I think that, you know, we wanted to key in on is like, I have an autistic son who's, you know, my youngest son, he's autistic, and my older one, my middle child is too, but he's, you know, I don't like using some of the terms, right, that the some people like to use, but he's just more, you know, he's kind of grown into himself, you know, in a sense, whatever, he's 17 now, but you know, it's like you really have to learn how to navigate a little bit differently, I think, prepare your children especially well when you're going on trips and going somewhere where it's going to be crowded, and then even to a capacity as veterans, right? A lot of times we just don't like being around big crowds and a lot of people. Mm-hmm. But for whatever reason, when you get into that realm of walking into a theme park like Disney specifically, because everybody's welcome. And I think they do a good job of ensuring that everybody's welcome. So there's all kinds of capacity and accommodations they make for, you know, family members, children, or adults, you know, whether you're immobile or whether you have a, you know, any form of disability, is like, they're going to do all they can really to ensure that you can come there and enjoy it. And that's something that I've appreciated. And so I think that's really what helped me fall in love with it, is I just knew like, I can take my son here and he can still have a good time despite the fact that, you know, in other capacities, it might get really frustrated. So, and we've learned in every trip, I learned something new on how to work with him. And then I've learned from you, and that's been really appreciative, you know? And like, so, I think that's a lot of it, you know, and like, I've never gone to Universal, you know, and like, cause I feel like he's not ready yet, but cause I feel like maybe it's a little bit more excitable. I don't know if this sounds wrong, but just like a little bit of a different vibe, you know, than walking into some of the Disney parks. So not to say that they can't ever be like really, really crowded, you know, or like you're watching for strollers, not to mangle your ankles. Just a different vibe kind of, you know? And so that's really like what kind of gets it for me, I guess, you know? Mm-hmm. And then, and same for you, like, so for you, like if you, you attack that one yourself.
Yeah. And I'm in a similar situation. I have one son who's autistic, and I've got another one who's wheelchair bound. So I have very much had to learn through the years how to navigate the parks myself with two very different disabilities, going to the parks and whatnot, and learning how to navigate and whatnot. And living here and going very frequently, I've kind of learned a lot of the secrets or shortcuts to be able to make the days a little bit easier whenever we go. And as far as, you know, avoiding those crowds, I've very much learned just to not go those days that are gonna be extremely hectic. So Sometimes there's definitely, you know, want to share what I've learned over time, because, you know, not everybody has the ability to show up all the time and learn those little tips and tricks.
Yeah, sure. And I think the idea behind, we've talked about it, like, part of what we want to do too is just to share that information, but ensure that people don't feel like there's a brick wall to being able to experience, you know, not just the Disney parks, but Universal, SeaWorld, or just travel in general, you know, going on cruises. You're an avid cruiser, and you take the boys. And so it's like, you're not, keeping them from doing something that you enjoy, but that they also should enjoy, and being able to share that with people so that they can do the same thing. I mean, it's not really, it can be a tough, you know, road to haul, whatever, but it's not necessarily like fair if people can't go and enjoy the other things that, you know, people do every day just because they might have, you know, some form of a disability. So it's great that you've experienced a lot of that. I'm experiencing it to a degree. And then, you know, the places that we go, it's just like, hey, you know, like one of my number one rules is these days is like, if it's somewhere that's not welcoming to my son, I just won't go. Like, I'm not gonna put my feet in there and you know, because I don't, you know, it's just the world for everybody, and that's how we have to keep it. Man, that's a big statement, but man, calm down. But so, you know, that's kind of the information, and we're building a website, and it's you know, getting rolling and everything, and we'll start producing more content, of course, one way or the other, and just try to share stuff as we go, and then hopefully we'll get some traction here and maybe get some community feedback too from things that people would like to learn more about, and we can share that stuff. So
but we also like to have some fun too.
Yeah, fun is good, you know, especially if it's mischievous and chaotic fun.
Is that a segue into
I guess it is. Otherwise I was gonna try to put like horns on my head, but then that would just be like look really weird. And and I guess this might also be like a point, maybe in editing, I'll put like a possible spoilers ahead. But if it's been more than 48 hours, it's your fault at this point. But, you know, because that's hard, man, especially with like really demanding, cool shows. You just get on Facebook now, you scroll or Twitter and you see something, you're like, oh, man, that's, you know, wrecked it. So I try to avoid that stuff as much as possible. But we both like Loki a lot, the series on Disney Plus, of course. That's just started its second season in the last, I guess, week, whatever. Mm-hmm. And it's just, for me, it's absolutely superior to anything else that they produced on Disney Plus besides, of course, it didn't escape me now, but the Rogue One prequel series, you know?
Right.
Like, that's, I think, really, really good too. But this, like, Loki's just been amazing. And anything, everything about it, I'm just like, and you got to rewatch it, because it's like we were messaging, and I'm like, I'm not remembering all these things that the episodes are kind of like harking back to. And so I went and I rewatched like the last two episodes from last season last night, and that really helps, because it's just like an awesome show. So so as far as the first two episodes of season two, what's been your viewpoint so far?
I think it's been crap.
Absolutely. Dog crap.
I've really enjoyed it. One thing that I've really enjoyed a little bit more about this season, more so than the first season of Loki even, is that it's actually allowed Loki, the character, to become more mischievous and back to his original self, or feel more like the original Loki as he was, as opposed to kind of the good guy trying to do the good stuff, like he was towards the end of Ragnarok or whatnot. You really felt it, especially in the second episode. You really felt him like doing the um just being Loki, just having fun, just, you know, doing this projection casting, you know,
just the shadows on the wall that got me. I was like, because initially I just thought, oh man, he's, you know, he's turning himself back into that. And then you just realize like it's actual just shadows. And I was like,
right,
that was cool. That was really, really cool. You know, when they're chasing the X5, I guess that's a good reference point there. But that was just like a super cool scene. But yeah, it's like he's kind of going back to, it's like he's still contained in a sense. Like he's using some kind of moral clause slightly, but he has the abilities honing it in, I guess, you know. And then the when they have him in the interrogation room and they use the gizmo.
Oh, yes, that was
so cool.
That was a fantastic interrogation scene. Again, letting Loki be Loki. Letting him, you know, show that he's kind of off the chains a little bit.
Yeah, like the suspense was there if he was, if he knew what he was doing or not with the the control, like the control device, and whether he was going to hit the wrong button and just like,
yeah,
that was good suspense there. And then I thought to myself, well, if he does, he does. You know, it's like,
right?
Are we going to see Brad again? I don't know.
I don't think we will. I think that was probably the end of him.
Go back to being a movie star in the 70s and
yeah,
very good time. Very Austin Powers ish.
But another thing that I really like, especially in the second episode, when they were eating the pie, and just, you know, a small little conversation, and Loki was over just talking to Mobius about, you know, losing his cool, and, you know, how he, Brad just said the wrong thing and got Mobius all upset. But then Loki kind of rephrased or recalled the time that he was mad at his brother and dad and held New York hostage, and and how that was, it wasn't a very strategic move on his part. It was more the emotional, and it kind of really changed it. It reconfigured how you kind of, you look back at the first Avengers movie and you realize that he really was unhinged during that whole movie. He wasn't his normal calculative trickster during that movie. He was very just aggressive and trying to,
he's like an immature, he just knew he could do it, and he was angry and pissed off, and he's adopted, and he just let everyone have it, and
right.
Whereas that was actually fascinating, yeah.
Where if he would have like taken a step back and gone about planning that attack on New York from a more strategic standpoint, he probably could have won it.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. I've always felt like he was, he's so powerful. I think his missteps have just been probably based on emotion. Yeah, like probably his missteps. If he was more strategically thinking about it, he wouldn't have trying to, you know, like the, when he's at Stark Tower and, you know, they have this fight or whatever. I mean, he could have easily disappeared or just whatever, but it's like he wanted to prove he, you know, was number one or whatever. And
right.
And then he was doing it on his own in essence too, I guess. Right. Like, I mean, he was just kind of having his own party, and not really, you know, teaming up with other bad guys. But now him being part of a team and then still like that connection with Sylvie is like he has to realize he needs to make that work in order for them to succeed is what it seems like. And he knows he can't do it on his own, which is almost like a real humbling of his personality.
Right. But it's just things like that, that those small little lines that really like help reframe a whole universe of movies that he had been part of previously.
How cool is it that they did 1980s McDonald's?
The interesting fact is that they, I read an article that they had pitched the idea of doing all that and everything, and then they went to McDonald's and then got funding from them. So it's very egregious, you know, product placement, and, you know, or obvious product placement for McDonald's, but they had it all set up before they got the money from McDonald's. So it was.
So if McDonald's would have said, no, we don't want anything to do with this, they were going to be like, all right, in and out.
They were going to do it anyway.
Yeah.
Because the idea of it was, you know, the happiness. And the idea of, you know, because, I mean, we grew up back then. We remember, I used to have birthday parties at McDonald's.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. The fry guys would show up and Ronald, and you were just like, it's the coolest thing ever.
So those were like happy, that McDonald's was a happy place back in the day.
Yep.
Before they, you know, had to take, get rid of the murder playpens.
and the ice cream machine's always down now, and then you just I don't know, it's almost reckless going into I don't know, man, maybe we shouldn't say that, you know, it might, McDonald's might watch this and get upset, you know, but if they do watch this, we've made it and we'll have attorneys, so no worries. All right, so
but maybe if they watch this, they'll actually fix the ice cream machine.
Yeah, come on, guys. And we need some chocolate dip. I really like that, and it was fascinating. It was really cool where Sylvie, like, that's where she found her escape and just wanted to stay there. And this, you know, and imagine having her walk in as it was, and the guy behind the counter is just like, he's like, can I help you? It's, she's like, yeah, you absolutely can give me everything. Yes. And my big giant dog's trying to make an appearance, I guess. He's a mess. But yeah, that was I love that scene there, and just how accurate everything was done. Uh-huh. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but there used to be McDonald's in the theme parks, right? Like in Magic Kingdom, where they used to like kind of like.
There was, yes. McDonald's had a partnership with Disney at one point where the fries that were served in Disney World and Disneyland were the McDonald's fries.
We could bring that back, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, no, I'm good with. I'm not a big fan of their fries.
McDonald's.
There's better ones out there.
Do you like the thicker potato cut, you know, the big fries, or do you like the thinner, salty?
I mean, the Checkers seasoned fries, those ones are good.
Yeah, I like seasoned fries.
Arby's curly fries, you can almost never go wrong with those.
You can buy those in a grocery store now. They come in a nice little frozen bag.
Yes, you can.
I've gotten
them a few times.
Yeah, now it's a craving. So another one, if Arby's, by all means, if you catch this, we're endorsing your fries. So, you know, feel free. So what else? What else about the second episode?
What's your thoughts on Kehu Kwan's character, OB?
Oh man, cool for one, really really cool, and. And it seems like maybe they're referencing, I don't want to say like angelic, but the fact that he wrote the book of, mm-hmm. I don't know, I'm hitting mics, the TVA book, and the way they kind of bandy it about, like it's the holy grail of their existence, you know, like every answer is in here. I don't know what you guys are asking, you know, but I just love that he's tinkering. He's the guy in the basement that's tinkering, but he has all the answers. He can fix things or whatever. It was really cool. Well, cool or fascinating, scary, whatever, is that when he was plugging in the temporal aura, right? The mm-hmm. one that I guess that he was working, like rebuilding or whatever, and he's plugging it in, but they were saying access denied, and he's like, that's bad. Because he figured like maybe he was really gonna solve a problem there. So you know, did someone build in a resistance or whatever, where but at the same time though, if he kind of built everything, did he build in something that's blockading himself from being able to fix it? It's interesting.
Well, he mentioned that Miss Minutes was usually there to help fix it. So maybe because she wasn't there, it was her temporal aura that was missing. Or
she's gone rogue. Serious rogue. That's another fascinating character. So what about you? What piqued your interest with that particular character?
Well, I really enjoyed him. He's a fun character. I read one theory online that suggests that he is a variant of Data from the Goonies.
That's like, well, is it the same actor?
Yes,
I didn't look him up. Okay, it is. Yeah. Okay, I thought so, because like for one, he sounds like him, but he kind of looks like him too. But I saw him in a movie recently too, where
Everything Everywhere All at Once.
Yeah. That was then. He won an Oscar for that, or the movie did. The movie did, right?
He won an Oscar. Yes.
So that was really cool. So I was like, yeah, I was thinking, that's the bridge, I guess. Mm-hmm. You know, that was pretty cool.
Yeah. But no, I think he's really fun. I think there's definitely a little bit more to his character than what we're seeing so far.
Do you think he's a god?
No, I don't think he's a god. But I think where earlier we were talking about maybe everybody's minds got wiped or whatnot, his might not have been. It's possible, because it sounds like he was there to help build from the beginning.
He said he's hundreds of years old, right?
Right. Which I believe everybody in the TVA is probably hundreds of years old at this point.
Yeah, I wonder how. What are they eating? Pie?
Pie. You know, I'm going to start eating lots more key lime pie.
It sounds like a plan.
Especially if it's neon green like that.
Yeah, that was pointed out. I was watching New Rock Stars, and they pointed that out. They're just like, why is the pie so green? You know, and how did they not know? But maybe they don't know any better. So, and why is there an entire wall full of key lime pie? There's another one.
That'd be heaven to me. That's my favorite pie.
So do you think that could possibly be keeping their brain cells flattened, you know, like to maybe the key lime pie is a tool to keep them from remembering or repressing memories or something like that? I wonder.
I guarantee there's something to it. They would not build an entire set of key lime pie if it was just to have one slice.
Random, totally random scene.
Yes. Yeah. There's definitely more to the pie than just.
Well, Loki didn't eat it, right? He didn't have anything. It was just
Mobius. He did have some.
Yeah. So it'd be curious if he starts forgetting maybe things from the past. We'll
see.
Yeah, that would be a really good indicator. But yeah, so those new episodes drop on Thursday nights, right?
Thursday nights.
Yeah, Thursday night. So I haven't seen any preview or trailer for episode 3. I mean, Disney loves keeping those close hold. I don't know. I guess maybe they're on YouTube. I just typically don't look.
I think they tend to push out a trailer or something midweek or something like that to remind you.
Yeah, I'm like, if you guys could do like what the other streamers do, where you just show a trailer at the end of the credits, maybe the end of the episode, that'd be so cool. You know, I'm still waiting for that big Disney Plus overhaul the format, maybe. I don't know.
Maybe when they do that, they'll up their subscription prices even more. So they
probably will. We did something really great for you guys. Wait, you made it just simpler and logical to use. You're like, calm down now. Yeah. It's hard to decommit. That's my problem. I'm such a follow through kind of guy, you know. It's just so hard to decommit from Disney Plus. Like, boy, FOMO is real. And Andor was what I was trying to write, because like I think Andor should be coming back maybe by the end of the year, or was it early 2024? I don't remember. I know everything with the strike, I'm sure everything's gotten pushed back.
But. Yeah, I'm not sure what happened with it or where they were at in filming or anything like that when the strikes began.
The other big series, though, that Disney Plus is supposed to drop by the end of the year for sure was the related to the Scarlet Witch, you know, but the other witch, the I'm so good at this. I'm so good at remembering things.
Yeah, Agatha.
Yes, yeah, and that, you are
good. That one they've announced has definitely been delayed.
Okay, so they were in the middle of filming.
So they have, so as far as upcoming series, they've said that Echo is going to be dropped in December, and they're going to drop all the episodes all at once.
Echo?
Echo.
Okay, I don't know much about Echo. Do you want to tell us about Echo?
She was in the Hawkeye series.
Oh, okay.
She was the girl who was deaf.
See, I'm like going, yeah, see.
It's been a couple years.
That was a good series, though. That was actually pretty good, too.
Right. You need to rewatch it again come Christmas time. That's now required watching, just like Die Hard.
It is a Christmas series. Now, okay, let's answer this one. Nightmare Before Christmas, Halloween movie or Christmas movie? Or can it be both? I say both.
Thanksgiving movie.
Thanksgiving, get it in between. Yeah. We're not watching this for Halloween. It's kind of a Christmas movie, but we're not really sure. So, because everyone puts out Halloween decorations that have Jack Skellington and everything. And, I mean, they are Halloween people.
I've got neighbors who put out Jack Skellington for Halloween and then just leave them up through the Christmas and call it good. You know,
I have pumpkins of Jack and Sally, and they're always sitting out. I mean, they're great decorations. What am I? I'm not going to put them away. Are you kidding me? So it's one of those things. I really enjoy it.
And they're selling. I put Christmas hats on come November 1st.
That's a good call too. Yeah. I guess they're selling like a 10 or 12 foot Jack Skellington at Home Depot or Lowe's or something like that.
My neighbor has one in front of his house. My dog does not appreciate it.
Oh no. I mean, I think that would scare most dogs and small children. I mean, that's giant. I'd just be afraid to get it because I'd be afraid someone would steal it or stab it in the middle of the night, you know? That would be very hurtful. Plus, it's like several hundred dollars, I'm sure. But yeah, that's my youngest. He's always really liked that movie. And it would be really cool if, besides at Disneyland where they do Oogie Boogie as Halloween party, right? Mm-hmm. If they would just implement a little bit more of Jack and Sally into Disney World as well. I know, I guess you can visit them. Right, like during the Halloween parties.
So yes, you can visit them at the Halloween party. A couple years ago, during the Halloween fireworks show, they had a giant Jack Skellington puppet come out and introduce the fireworks. But they got rid of that for some reason.
Not sure. Couldn't find someone tall enough.
Yeah, I don't know. For the upcoming Christmas party at Hollywood Studios, they're going to do an overlay for the Frozen sing-along show, where it's going to be Nightmare Before Christmas sing-along. So that'll be interesting.
Yeah, that's cool.
I do have tickets for that, so excited to try that out.
Yeah, no, that'll be cool, man. I'll be eager to see, like, people's videos from things like that. So I know, like, we've discussed, like, I'll watch streamers in the parks, and you're on the opposite end of that. Like, you know, you'd like, well, you don't really watch a lot of preview stuff though either, right? Because you like to get a taste for it firsthand. Is that right?
I do, yes.
Yeah, I don't know. I just like the FOMO thing. I end up watching something, you know.
So you just need to pack your bags and just get on out here.
Get a little bit easier, and that would work out really well. Exactly. And then I can be the filmer. But I enjoy the streamers, because, like, when you don't live there, it's easier. I mean, not easier, right? But you just kind of get a feel like you're there a little bit. But you got to be choosy with your streamer. You know, not everybody catches that vibe, you know, but there's some good ones out there. You know, and just walk along. It's like, there's a really good guy, like, watching. I'll plug him. I think it's just 4KWDW. And he doesn't speak. He just does videos where he's walking around shooting a 4K. But he has one on Caribbean Beach just from the other day. And I think it was raining too, whatever. It was just like perfect, you know? You could smell it. Yeah, you could smell the chlorine in the pool. It was great, you know? But that's my favorite resort, of course. My favorite other resort is the JD house. So we'll go there. I won't forget. Yeah, but anyway. So you want to wrap up? Has this been long enough?
I think this has been enough for
vlogcast.
I don't want to lose our audience in the first episode.
Yeah.
You know, well, all the one people that will tune in.
You never know, man. You got to push that SEO. But
I appreciate you.
That's right. If we try to, you know, get something out every couple of weeks or whatever, you know, we'll just get a groove going, maybe a little more, and we'll just see how it grows and escalates, you know. And I'm sure, like, at some point we might talk a little bit more about traveling into the parks or, you know, the other experiences and stuff. So this is just essentially our first little taste, and a taste for you guys, hopefully more than one. And we'll go again. Working on a website. It'll be pixiedustbrigade.com, and socials will use the same name, stuff like that. And so that'll probably do it, I guess, huh?
I think so.
Yeah, well, enjoy your Florida evening. I'll enjoy my Texas evening as much as I can. I think it's like 90 degrees still, whatever. So we'll have a good one. So, all right, man. Good first step.
All right. Thank you much.
Yep. Just a little bit of pixie dust.